بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is a very important talk when it comes to clinical practice that each doctor need to know the approach that we're going to describe in this lecture. And this lecture will fall under the clinical track. And for those who are following my YouTube channel, as I said many times before, that my talks will fall under six tracks. The clinical track is one of them. And if you would like to know what are the six tracks that I mean, you can subscribe to my channel and listen to my previous lectures. But let's start today's talk. Today's talk is going to be how to reach a clinical diagnosis. And I will show you what I mean by this. And I will start with this question. If I ask you, what is the most important question in medicine? What is the most important question? It comes when practicing medicine. And I can tell you the most important question, the answer for this question, the most important question that you should ask yourself always when you practice medicine is why? And the answer for this question is why. The most important question that you should ask yourself while practicing medicine is why. And let me tell you what I mean by this. On our daily practice, we are presented with patient problems, many problems. Any problem can be presented to us. For example, baby is hypotensive. So you can give him some inotropes or some vasopressors. Baby have hyponatremia. Okay, let's give him some sodium. The baby is a heart rate is low. So let's stimulate him. That's not the way to practice medicine. You have to ask yourself why. Before you treat a patient for any problem, the first question that you should ask yourself is why. The baby is less active. Why the baby is less active? He was active before. So what happened to him? The baby heart rate is low. Baby is bradycardic. So why become bradycardic? Baby was not bradycardic before. The blood pressure is high. Why? The urine output decreased. Why? The sodium is low. Why? The baby is vomiting. Why? And so on. Get yourself to the practice of asking yourself why before you're managing the problem. Why the baby now having such problem? Why the baby is presented now with such problem? Because before you ask yourself why, this is a picture in front of you. Nothing is clear. You cannot see the exactly what is the problem. You didn't search for the other things and the other clues that the baby might give you to clarify this picture. And that's why I always said, don't wait for problems to happen. You go search for problems. When the baby is presented with one problem, it's your job now to go search and look in all the sources that you can look in to see if the baby have other problems or this is baby only presented with one problem. And that will come by data collection. So to answer the question why, you have to collect data. But where are you going to collect data from? First, from your patient, of course. Examine your patient and see. Second, look to the monitor. If the patient on a monitor, look in the data that it is in the monitor. You look to the patient file, look at the vitals, look at the saturation, look at the oxygen requirements. You look to the labs like ABG, like CBC. If there's x-rays or radiology done, look images, any images, look at it. If there is any ECG or any other studies, look at it. And then also ask the nursing staff. So now you are collecting data about your patient to know why the baby have such a problem. Look in the record, like we said, look on the vitals, look on the CBC, other investigations like electrolytes. Look at trends. If the monitor is giving you trends, look at the trends of the patient. If you don't have technology and you don't have computer, you might have like a paper record like this. Look in your paper record. This paper record has a lot of information about the patient. It has ventilator settings, it has labs, it has bilirubin, has x-rays, have medications. A lot of things you can get also from a hard copy like this. You don't need the technology if you don't have it. Okay, so now we said the patient is presented with problem. You will ask yourself why the patient is having a problem. And let me show you this example in that way. For example, you have a patient now presented with hypotension. So the first thing you will ask yourself is why the baby is hypotensive. And you want to analyze this problem further. How? You'll ask how the blood pressure was measured. Was it measured invasive or non-invasive? If it is not, if it is measured invasive, where was the arterial line? If it is non-invasive, where the blood pressure cuff was taken from? What is the hypotensive part? Is it systolic or diastolic or both? Also, you need to know the other vitals. How is the heart rate? How is the urine output? How is the perfusion? Is there any blood loss or no? Is there any, what is other lost blood gas which was done? And then if there is, you have echo, how is the contractility and how is the filling? And if there is functional echo done, what is the result of this functional echo? So now you're asking why the baby is hypotensive. You're analyzing the problem. You're gathering information from the sources that you have to answer the question why the patient is hypotensive. Patient might present with another problem, vomiting, for example, or gastric residual like we see here. Then you're going to ask why the patient is vomiting or why the patient has gastric residual. Again, analyze the problem. What is the volume of the gastric residual? What is the color? Is it bilious, non-bilious? What is the frequency? It's happening with every feeding or it's happening only once a day? How is the bowel movement? Is the bowel open or not? This could rule out obstruction. How are the vitals? If the baby is hypotensive, if the baby is tachycardic, the baby might be septic here. How is the general condition of the baby? Is the baby active, not active? What's your abdominal examination? Is the baby abdomen is soft, lax, tender? Bowel sounds. Baby have bowel sounds or the abdomen is silent. Also, if there is an x-ray or any images done, what was the result of the last x-ray? Okay, sometimes the patient can be presented with more than one problem. Sometimes the baby can be presented or the patient can be presented with two problems. Like here, the baby presented with hypotension and gastric residual. Then after you analyze each problem separately, you're going to ask yourself, is there any diagnosis that could link these two problems together? Is there any diagnosis that could link hypotension and gastric residual? Of course, that you have what comes to mind first is sepsis, and also might be necrotizing enterocolitis. Okay, so now after you ask why, after you gather information and analyze the problem, the picture is just like this. You clarified the picture. Now you can take decision. Now you can manage this patient. Let's apply what I said in a case. Let's get a case scenario and let's apply what we discussed now. This is baby present. This is baby's 14 days old. He's X 30 weeks preterm infant. Mean his corrected age now is 32 weeks. The patient is on full feeds and his weight is 1650 gram. The baby was placed in CPAP from the delivery room. Means he's stable for a long time. And now the baby is stable on nasal cannula flow, 2 liters per minute, and the FiO2 30% for the last 2 days. Tonight, the nurse noticed that the baby has been tachycardic. So this is something new now. It was not there before. So what would you like to do next? We said what we'd like to do next. The first thing you would like to do is to ask why the baby is tachycardic. And then how you will do this? We said you will do this by gathering information and analyzing the problem. Analyzing the problem here, how high was the tachycardia, since when, what was the pattern, was it irregular or non-irregular, was it arrhythmia, non-arrhythmia, and so on. So now, to answer the question, you need to gather information. Where you will gather information, we said, patient, monitor, you will labs like EBG, CBC, X-ray, ECG, nursing information, patient record, electrolytes and labs, trends. So you will gather information from any sources you have. For example, if you have history, how high was the tachycardia, like we said, and since when? So this you know from the history. You do physical examination for the patient with all the items listed there. You look on the monitor to see the vitals and the rhythm and the pattern of breathing. Look at the file to know the saturation, the oxygen requirements, the urine output, the feeding, is there any feeding intolerance or no, if there's any medication. You look at the labs, CBC, CRP, glucose, culture, electrolytes, gas. Look images like any images done and also to see the ECG. So you are now gathering information. So let's apply what we said. So before, when you are presented with a problem, the first thing you will do, look at the right-hand side here. The patient is presented with tachycardia. So the first thing you will do, you will ask why, and you will come with a differential diagnosis, like what we see here on the right-hand side of the slide. This is all the things that you thought of that can cause tachycardia, sepsis, fever, anemia, agitation, pain, hypotension, dehydration, arrhythmia, medication, and electrolyte imbalance. All these problems can cause tachycardia, all these diagnoses. But you cannot treat a patient like this. This is what I said in the beginning. The picture is not clear. You don't know which one of these diagnoses causing the tachycardia. So you cannot manage the patient like this. Now you have to narrow this diagnosis. How you will narrow this diagnosis? Let's see now. Now you will gather information. So the nurse is telling you the heart rate is 185 for the last 6 hours. The baby is active. It doesn't look he's in pain. Maybe she's doing like a pain score, or she's looking at the patient and the pain score is low, or agitated. Patient is not agitated and has been only on caffeine since admission. Now let's go back to our differential diagnosis. Can we now narrow this diagnosis? Let's see. Sepsis, it might be. You cannot rule it out from the information that you got so far. But agitation, yes. Patient, the nurse told you the baby doesn't look agitated. And also his pain score is low. So he also doesn't look to her in pain. Medications, maybe the baby on caffeine. Caffeine rarely will cause tachycardia, but we will put a question mark here. And maybe the baby had a high dose by error or whatever. So we put it a question mark. Okay, now you still have a lot of diagnoses left. You need to gather more information. So now you go check the vitals. Vitals were normal, and within normal limits, apart from this tachycardia. Now go back to our differential diagnosis. Could we exclude other diagnoses? Of course, yes. We said the vitals are normal, so fever is gone. Hypotension is also cancelled. So now we further narrow our differential diagnosis. But I still cannot manage this patient because I still have sepsis, anemia, dehydration, arrhythmia, medication, electrolyte imbalance. Which one I will treat here? So here, this is information is not enough. I need to go gather more information. Now we gather where we know that the patient, we look to the patient file. We knew that the patient on 150 ml per kilo per day and the urine output is 3 ml per kilo per hour. And there are no stools. Can we rule out some of our diagnosis? Yes, we can rule out dehydration because the baby doesn't look dehydrated. He's getting enough fluid and he's passing enough urine. Doesn't seem to be like he's in dehydration. So dehydration now you can cancel. Still not enough. Still need more information to narrow the diagnosis further than that. Look in the monitor. Is this monitor looks like an arrhythmia? No, it looks like tachycardia. I don't see an arrhythmia there. So now you can rule out also arrhythmia. Now we further narrow the differential diagnosis, but still I have sepsis, anemia, I have medication problems and electrolyte imbalance, and this is not enough for me. I cannot treat all this. I need to further narrow the diagnosis. So now I need to do what we'd like to do next. Now we need some labs. Okay, we looked to the labs. We found that the baby didn't actually have labs from the last week. So these labs now cannot help me. So I need extra labs. So what did we do? We did electrolytes, CBC, and CRP. Now let's look at the electrolytes. The electrolytes looks within normal limit. And look at the CBC, the hemoglobin. What happened here to the hemoglobin? The hemoglobin was 10, now is 9. So there's no much difference in the hemoglobin. So now the anemia that you were thinking of, you put again a question mark around it, doesn't look like this is anemia. There is no severe drop in the hemoglobin that could explain this tachycardia. Electrolyte imbalance, now you canceled because doesn't look, the electrolyte looks normal. So now you narrow your diagnosis further. But there's something interesting in the CBC. Look at the WBC is increased from 12,000 in the last week to 21,000 this week. Not just this, look at the platelet count trend. It decreased from 220 to 160. These both things now are pointing towards that this baby actually might be septic. Anemia, as we said, is not now on the top of your diagnosis. Anemia is not on the top of your diagnosis. We ruled out already electrolyte imbalance, and anemia doesn't look like to be, as we said, So now you are really suspecting, you left with only two diagnoses now, either sepsis or medications. As I said, medications, caffeine rarely cause tachycardia and has a wide margin of error, seldom cause tachycardia. The baby probably maybe had a high dose of caffeine by error, but that's not really your first suspicion. All that information that we gather right now will increase your suspicion about sepsis, and your first diagnosis here will be sepsis, because sepsis can lead to this tachycardia and can lead to increased white count and can cause also the decreased trend in the platelets. So in this scenario, the culture was done and the baby was initiated on antibiotics. This is what I would I try to tell you, that that's how you should manage. We present with a problem, you have a differential diagnosis, you go look to all the sources that you have to gather information about your patient, you narrow your diagnosis from the information you get, as the way I showed you. And I want to leave you with one statement: always remember the power of why, and always start your practice medicine with why. And the conclusion of this is always ask yourself why when you practice medicine. And I hope this will modify your clinical practice and modify your approach to clinical problems. And I thank you very much.